Now, it was 9 years ago, almost to the month, that I stood in this very spot here at Rolfe's Lake and talked about the world's most expensive pole. That lofty accolade was held by Daiwa back then with their air pole. And now, nearly a decade on, Daiwa still hold the prize, but we have the Air Z Pro. And with a lofty £7,000 RRP, does it really live up to its billing? £6,999.99 is an awful lot of money for a pole. But if you shop around, truth is you're going to find it for under £5,000. Not much under £5,000, but you will get it for under £5,000. But at that price, it's nearly £1,000 more than some of its flagship rivals. These include MAP's 1001 3G, Mavis Super Lithium, Matrix's MTX4 Ultra, Browning Sphere Zero GT, Colmic's Nuclear A16, Drenner's Acolyte Pro, Garbo's excellent UK1 Accomplice, Preston's brand new Superium X90, and MIDI's award-winning Reactor Core X65. All great poles within their own right, but are they as good as this one? Let's find out. Now, if you're in the market for a top-end pole like the Air Z Pro, chances are you're already a very good pole angler, and you will know that your investment is going to buy you the finest that you can get. You want the pole to be lighter, stiffer, and stronger than anything you've ever seen before. But have we actually come that far in the last 10 years since I saw the last very expensive Daiwa model? Well, let me tell you, material-wise, it doesn't get any better than this. It's built using Daiwa's Hyper MSG nanocarbon. It has the bias joints, it's got section aligners, it has the diamond satin finish, and on the top of the pole, you have Daiwa's taping ITS system, which naturally makes it slippy in the hand, but doesn't add any weight. In tiny increments, it's better than the Airity, the Air, and the Air Z. It is that little bit better. Now the pole, as you can see it on the rollers, is set up with a match top two on it. And for my money, with the match top two on, it is the best pole in the world. However, it's a pimple on a supermodel moment, the tiniest of blemishes. This is Daiwa's top two kit. Now, I'm used to fishing with Daiwa poles. I've had quite a few over the years, and it's my belief that their tournament models are designed with this top kit, which incidentally can be used with some fairly heavy elastics, and it suits the pole. It's ridiculously rigid, super responsive, and very, very stiff. This is the inter-elastic kit that Daiwa sell with this pole. There's nothing wrong with it. It's designed to be used with heavier elastics or hollow elastics, and it is a little bit longer, so it's ultimately going to be a bit heavier than the match top two kit. And I would say that up to sort of 13 or even 14 and a half meters, it doesn't make, there is no discernible difference. But at 16 meters, there's just that tiny little bit of feeling of, you know that you've got a heavier top kit in. It wouldn't stop me from buying one, but I think it's worth mentioning. And after all, if you've parted with nearly £5,000 of your hard-earned money, why wouldn't you have an opinion? So I've waited a bit for a bite, but and the lake is apparently had ice on it yesterday, but there is a very good reason for coming to Rolfe's, and that's because the fish in here are absolute brutes. And if you ever wanted to test a pole to find out how strong it were, this is the place to come. Quite risky of me, really, considering how much money it is, and if I break it, I'll certainly be charged. But yeah, so far so good. I've fished it at 16 meters with an inter-elastic kit and white hydro, so pretty standard winter stuff for carp, really. It is incredibly stiff, which is what you expect it to be. Finish is nice, which again you expect it to be. But as you can see, there is an awful lot of strength. Section wall strength is good. I don't feel that there's going to be any accidents happening here. And the fish is coming a little bit closer, so we'll break down at that. I do quite like to get the top kit into my hand as quickly as possible. It's just my way. And I think if you use quite a light elastic, you can do that. The problem you have at a place like Rolfe's is the fish, you know, can could be 20 plus, which they're not really for poles, but we'll see. But you have to be impressed with that, because at 16 metres on a tight line like that was, yeah, it really is a quality pole. There's absolutely no denying that. And although I touched on the difference between the match kits and the inter-elastic kits earlier, fishing for fish like this, you know, you want something like an inter-elastic kit, because you do need that extra wall strength, you know? I mean, we haven't got this fish out and we're not close to it yet, but oh my word, it feels absolutely immense. There is a mat on the other side of the lake, which they've had one carp, so it isn't, you know, it's probably winter at Rolfs isn't the easiest of times. So we'd like to get this one out. Oh dear, oh dear. It's got a branch attached to it now. Oh dear. So we have a carp and a tree. This will be fun. I don't think, when it comes to timber, I don't think that there's a pole that's particularly good at handling wood. But we've got three of it now. Now there are a couple of other considerations when you're buying a pole of this type and this much money that you have to consider it. This is a very important part of buying poles like this. The fact that Daiwa poles are made here in the UK, albeit in Scotland, means that spares are readily available. Should you need them, and there is no denying that the residual value of a Daiwa pole is better than any other. You know, you'll never get what you paid for it. It just doesn't work like that. But you will get, you know, should you want to upgrade, and Daiwa at some point will bring out another pole, and you know, you may wish to upgrade, you will get more. You'll get a decent price back on it, you know, because Daiwa poles are much sought after, and I don't think that is liable to upset anybody in the trade. It's just a fact of poles, you know. Daiwa poles have a good residual value, and if you're spending £5,000, then why would you not consider that? You know, I certainly would. I don't actually think we're winning this this battle. Nice 5 or 6 pounder had been handy, but it's not going to happen. I suppose that's why you come here, but it's definitely squeaky bum stuff. What I don't get with Rolfs fishes, most carp, you lead them in and, you know, and they have a bit of a struggle on it. You know, eventually they give up. Now, this is cold water, and every time I get it anywhere near, it just charges off again. It's because they're commons, that's why. They're just mad things, commons. No. You know, sometimes you just don't think you're going to get a fish out, and I'm beginning to think that with this. Maybe we're just gaining a little bit of line, a bit of elastic, sorry, back. It's probably because it's running at me and it's just about to charge off across the other side of the lake. There, we've picked up another branch. Oh my life, what is the matter with this fish? Mm. you expect it from chub, you know, they go crashing into everything, but you don't expect it from carp. You know, you think, oh, they won't, you know, they don't go crashing into things, but obviously these fish clearly do, and I've just seen it, and it's not the sort of thing you want to be catching on a pole, really.
A few moments later.
We might get one more chance, but unfortunately, I think I'm going to need a bigger net. Let's just see if we can get a bit more elastic back. I think everything's at a limit. Something will go at some point, especially if it hits another branch. It's been on so long now that and I can feel it rubbing on all sorts of things down there. In fact, I actually think that it's broken the elastic. I think the elastic has sort of given up here. However, it is a bit too big for the net, to be honest. But we have got it. And if you ever wanted proof that 5,000 pound brought you a bit of strength in pole, that's it. No idea how big it is, but it's too big for a pole.